one of the biggest causes of deficiency, and this can go, you could put in fill in the blank, it doesn't just have to be calcium, but it's high sugar diet. High sugar is no good for calcium, but in particular too, it's high sodium diet. Sodium, excessive sodium causes calcium excretion through the kidneys. So, if you're the kind of person that's, you know, fast food, processed box food, where they add a lot of the MSGs and other sodium-based items, that's a quick way to become calcium deficient. That's why so many of these different foods in the grocery store, you know, you notice what I didn't put up here under sources of calcium is it didn't put up fortified foods. You know, they're now fortifying orange juice with calcium. They're fortifying a lot of different foods. It's because when you have to fortify a food, it means that food, the quality of that food, and the nutrient density of that food, to put it just very bluntly, sucks. And you don't want to consume garbage food that's been fortified artificially so that you can get the adequate nutrition in your diet. You want to eat real food. So this, remember the three rules of nutrition, right? Rule number one, you can't get healthy eating food that isn't healthy. And so that falls under number one as a cause for the deficiency. But what else do we see causing calcium deficiency? There's several other things. Now, one, and this isn't to pick on coffee drinkers, or tea drinkers, but excessive coffee and tea consumption leads to calcium excretion through the urine as well, and it has to do with the caffeine. So this would, we could go to say under as a subheading under here, energy drinks. So if you like your Red Bull or Monster or whatever it might be, you know, these are things that excessive caffeine is going to cause calcium loss through the urine. So it's a really bad idea to overdo this. Now, does that mean you can't have a cup of coffee in the morning? No, it doesn't mean that. Does that mean you can never have a cup of tea? No. We're talking about the big drinkers, right? The ones that you know, that I'll only drink one cup a day and the cup is like a 20-ounce, like, mega cup, right? Like, I'm talking about 6 ounces being, 6 to 8 ounces being the cup, is probably okay. It's when you get into the higher moderate to heavy coffee and tea consumption where you can start to see problems with calcium metabolism and calcium absorption. And calcium excretion really start to kick in. Another one on this list is alcohol. Alcohol also works through a diuretic action, but it also through the stomach. Alcohol can basically deacidify the stomach. You need stomach acid to absorb calcium. It's actually one of the other causes. We'll go ahead and put that in there. But antacid medications. What I find very ironic is you'll see sometimes the commercials like for Tums, Rolaids, Tums, where they say, now with calcium, right? Get your calcium. I had a client one time come in to see me, and she was calcium deficient. We knew because we actually properly tested her. And she had a follow-up visit with her OB-GYN like a week later, and she goes in to see the OB-GYN, and the OB-GYN says, oh, you don't need calcium supplements, just take Tums. Buy the Tums with Rolaids. So the OB-GYN, who's supposed to be a doctor, supposed to be educated, right, supposed to have some biochemistry background and knowledge, told my client to use Tums, which is an antacid, Tums because it had calcium in it as a source of dietary calcium. And so, very, very bad advice in that regard. So alcohol, antacids, and this goes with any antacid, by the way, Prevacid, Tagamet, Nexium. So if you're taking something that reduces stomach acid, even antihistamines, many of your antihistamine products for allergies can reduce your stomach acid output, and that can affect your ability to properly break calcium off of the food to make it ready for absorption. So you got to be careful there. Now, other things that can cause calcium deficiency, you know, aside from interventional things, let's just talk about who is possibly at risk. Like, what are the people? Who are the people that might have a calcium problem? Probably the ones that are most at risk are children. And the reason why is their skeletal structures are forming, they're growing, and they're growing very rapidly, and they hit big growth spurts. And so that's where we're going to have times where we might see their diet not suffice, especially in today's modern world where so many kids are eating these highly sugar, highly, you know, refined cereals and processed foods that are fortified with calcium, but they're only fortified with it because they have such horrible levels of it, or they have new anti-nutritive values to them that they're being fortified as a stopgap instead of eating right, which to me is the wrong message. We don't want stopgaps. We want to be educated and we want to make good decisions. But children are at really great risk, predominantly because of their fast and expedient growth, especially after, you know, again, hitting those growth spurts. Other people at risk here, people that avoid sunshine. Sunshine avoidance can cause a major calcium problem. And again, we go back to kind of some of the myths, you know, of what we've been told. And one of them is that sunshine causes skin cancer, which it absolutely, that's a ludicrous statement. It's kind of like saying water causes drowning. Sure, it does, but you need enough water for that to happen. It's the same thing with sunshine. You need enough to burn yourself repetitively over time. But regular daily sunshine that doesn't cause burning is necessary for humans to be healthy. And remember what it helps your skin produce. It helps your skin produce vitamin D. Now, why is that important? Because vitamin D talks to your intestines and it tells your intestinal cells to absorb calcium from the diet. That's actually where calcium is absorbed, is in your small intestine. About 65% of your absorption occurs in your distal small intestine, your ileum, which is the area of the small intestine that occurs right before the large intestine. And that pH in that area needs to be somewhere around 6.5 to 7.5 for ideal calcium absorption. So there's another reason why a lot of that garbage food, because it acidifies the GI tract. It also helps with yeast overgrowth, which also will acidify the GI tract. Once that pH drops below 6, really below 6.5, calcium absorption starts to reduce. So ideally, the pH in the intestine should be around 6.5 to 7. And you should have adequate vitamin D through sunshine exposure that those cells can be told to properly absorb calcium. But that vitamin D is also very important because it helps tell the kidney to retain calcium, to not excrete calcium through the urine. So these are this is a critical element in order for you to be able to maintain adequate quantities of your calcium and not lead to, you know, to a major deficiency. Hey, and if you missed the earlier part of this series, click right here so you can go back and get caught up. The information there might be critical to helping you on your path to better health. And as always, thanks for tuning in. Make sure you subscribe for updates below. Have a great day.